Anyone Who Had a Heart by Mia Dolan. Read by Annie Aldington. Chapter 1. 1967. The first thing Marcie Brooks had noticed about Father Justin O'Flanagan was his eyes. They bulged slightly, and his pale pupils were fringed with yellow, like watery egg yolks. On that first meeting, she'd been only 11 years old, and still under the impression that only devils had yellow in their eyes. The fact that a priest owned such eyes was worrying, and made her suspicious that hell and all its wickedness had infiltrated the Holy Church. From that moment on, she tried to avoid looking at him, always hanging her head rather than facing him head on. She knew he was coming today. Her grandmother had informed her as such. And although she told herself she was a big girl now, the memory of those eyes had stayed with her. "There's nothing to be afraid of. He's just a man," she whispered to her baby daughter. Joanna was lying pink and sleeping, dark lashes flickering as she dreamed her innocent dreams. Looking at her, Marcie was reminded of Johnny, her baby's father. Their love had been short-lived, but very sweet, cut short by an accident on the North Circular, when Johnny's motorcycle had collided with a lorry. If he'd lived, they would have married, and Joanna would have had a father. As it was, Marcie had been left an unmarried mother and had to return home to Sheppey to live with her grandmother. Not that Father Justin was aware of that fact. Her grandmother had lied on her behalf, saying that Marcie's husband had been killed. "I'm sure the Holy Mother will forgive me," she exclaimed after crossing herself. "And Father Justin is not the sort to indulge in idle gossip." Marcie hoped she was right. She was having this baptism done for her grandmother's sake. Her days of church going had stopped years before, and the thought of going to confession in the sure knowledge that Father Justin was on the other side of the screen filled her with horror. Someday she might feel differently, but not now.
"Just to please your great-grandmother," she said to the sleeping child.
Marcie had been through a lot in the last year. At times, since Johnny's death, she'd even found herself questioning what sort of God would have taken her baby's daddy away from her.
"But we won't say a word to Granny, will we? We'll do this just for her."
She smiled lovingly at the baby, at the same time as a pain tightened in her chest.
"And you are like your father," she said, softly stroking the pretty pink cheek of the child she so loved.
Thinking of Johnny brought other memories flooding back. One above all others she tried to block from her mind. She'd been foolish enough to trust her friend's father as a shoulder to cry on. Her trust had turned out to be ill-judged. He'd taken advantage of her naivety and inexperience. For a while, she'd even feared that the child might be his. He'd certainly been convinced of it. There was no longer any doubt about that in her heart. Joanna was the spit of her father. She'd never pressed charges against Alan Taylor, her friend's father. It was her word against his, after all. And she did have something to be grateful to Alan for. If he hadn't come and collected her from the home for unmarried mothers, Joanna would have been given up for adoption. So far, since coming back to Sheppey, she'd managed to avoid him. However, this particular meeting could not be avoided. Her grandmother, Rosa Brooks, had been born on a Mediterranean island where the Catholic Church was as necessary to life as the air itself. Following her marriage to a handsome, though slightly irresponsible, sailor in the British Royal Navy, Rosa Brooks had exchanged the Mediterranean island of Malta for the island of Sheppey. Her visits to the confessional and the mass were reduced to once a week. She'd never forced Marcie or the rest of the family to attend if they didn't want to. Marcie didn't want to, but special occasions could not be avoided.
"Joanna must be baptized," exclaimed her grandmother. Marcie couldn't argue with that.
She didn't want her darling daughter to bear any of the sin she herself felt responsible for. Dislike for the priest faded the moment she looked down at her sleeping daughter. Her cheeks were pink, and blue veins, as fine as cobwebs, showed in her eyelids. Marcie couldn't resist gently touching the sleeping child's fingers. The sound of the garden gate opening heralded the priest's arrival. Glancing out, she saw him sweep up the garden path, his black robe skirting over heavy black boots, the sort that a docker might wear. Before going downstairs, she stood in front of the mirror, checked that there was no trace of makeup on her face and that her hair was tidy. She also rehearsed her answer to the number one question he was likely to ask. "Why haven't I seen you at confession, child?"
"I went away to work in London, which is where I married Johnny, Joanna's father."
Her grandmother calling for her to come down was the signal for her to take her wedding ring from the small tin box that held her less than extensive jewellery collection. The curtain ring was a bright and brassy alternative for the real thing, and at a quick glance would fool anyone. Eyeing it too closely would betray what it really was, but being a mother and widowed was preferable to being a mother and unmarried. Father Justin O'Flanagan was sitting on the settee in the front room, balancing a plate on his lap and holding a cup and saucer with both hands. The front room was rarely used, so was chilly compared to the rest of the cottage, known as No. 10 Endeavour Terrace. The old gas fire spluttered intermittently with small blue flames amongst the amber.
"Take a seat, Marcie," said her grandmother, indicating the armchair on the opposite side of the fireplace to her own.
Father Justin had an oblong face and a wide mouth that seemed to stretch from one side of his pallid countenance to the other. When he smiled, his mouth resembled a letterbox, so straight it was, and gaping, as if ready to devour the Morning Post.
"Ah, Marcie, I'm glad to see you, child."
His Irish brogue grated from his throat, as though he were forcing his words over a layer of gravel.
"Good morning, Father Justin."
She gave a curt nod of her head, which was useful, seeing as it meant she could avoid looking into his yellow eyes, and instead turn her attention to the teapot.
"'Tis nice to see you, Marcie, but I was sad to hear about your husband."
Marcie thanked him for his sympathy. Father Justin had not visited the house so much as he used to, not approving of her father's divorce and remarriage. She wondered what he'd thought of her real mother. It crossed her mind that she could ask him what she was like, but the thought of having to take tea with him put her off. Those eyes would be boring into her. She couldn't cope with that. Her grandmother, perhaps sensing what was on her granddaughter's mind, took the conversation in the right direction.
"As you know, Marcie, Father Justin has come to discuss having Joanna baptized."
Her grandmother's jet-black eyes scuttled between her granddaughter and priest. Although she'd been in England some years, her obeisance to a priest and all things Catholic had never quite gone away. Nevertheless, she said it all with some pride, almost as though no other grandchild in all the wide world had ever been so privileged.
"Of course," said Marcie.
"Your grandmother tells me your husband died in a road accident before the child was born. That's very sad indeed."
Seeing as she was supposed to be a poor young widow, it was easy to get away with hanging her head and not looking at him this time. She nodded accordingly.
"That's right, Father. He was riding his motorbike."
"Ah, yes," said the priest, nodding his head in understanding. "It would be a motorbike. Dangerous things they are."
He took a big mouthful of cake and swigged back some tea. Seeing as both plate and cup were empty, her grandmother took them and asked if he required a refill. Of course he did. Father Justin had a big appetite and an insatiable desire for fruitcake, especially of the homemade variety that her grandmother produced.
"Never mind, child," he said, leaning across and patting her hand.
She instinctively placed her right hand over her left so the ring.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.